Welcome to my secret place devotion with Oyiks, Alfred. The Word of God is alive and equipped to change your life.
Good morning and welcome to a new month. We're going to pray and then we're going to look into the Word of God. The Bible tells us in 1 Corinthians chapter 15 verse 58, it says, "Dear brothers and sisters, be strong and immovable. Always walk enthusiastically for the Lord, for you know that nothing you do for the Lord is ever useless." I read from the New Living Translation. So we're going to ask God to help us never to forget that working for Him is profitable, so that we're able to serve God enthusiastically. Father, we thank you so much for bringing us into a new month. We do not take it for granted. We are grateful. Lord, I pray for your people. Cause us to always remember that serving you pays. Thank you, Lord, for the grace to serve you this month in the name of Jesus. I ask that you bless and increase your people beyond today, oh God, throughout this entire month in Jesus' name. Amen. The prayer that we pray today is very, very apt because it focuses on us serving the Lord. And that also means it focuses on God's deepest desires, because most people don't even recognize that God has needs. God's major need is that He wants all men to work for Him. He wants all men to serve Him. It doesn't matter what your career description is. It doesn't matter what your job is. It doesn't matter what you do in life. God wants you to serve Him. But the question is, serve Him doing what? Well, the underlining thing that God wants all of us to do is to get involved in the business of discipling men. Whether you're the president of a nation, whether you're a class teacher, if you're an engineer, if you work in the bank, whatever it is you do, the primary calling of every Christian is to be engaged in the business of discipling men. Which is why in Matthew 28 verse 19 to 20, it says, "Therefore go and make disciples of all nations, baptizing them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teaching them to obey everything I have commanded you, and surely I am with you always to the very end of the age." Now, this is a great commission. It is a commission that Jesus gave all of His children. He wants us to go about the business of discipling men. Our nation doesn't necessarily mean a geographical nation, but wherever you are is your nation. Your office space is your nation. Your business space is your nation. Your family is your nation. And this assignment is what He gave every single person who calls himself or herself a child of God. You can't ignore this commission and pretend it is not in the Bible and at the same time say that you are a child of God or you are serving God. In whatever capacity you are serving God, you must be involved in discipling men. The reason is because the greatest problem of the church, and the reason the church is in total disgrace and in disrepute all over the world, people don't regard the church as anything serious. People don't regard Christians as anything serious because, you know, Christians' lifestyle are just very far from what is written in the scripture. When you meet a Christian, you can't really tell that he's a Christian because he behaves exactly like the world. And the reason this is happening is because we have a lot of people who have asked Jesus come into their hearts, but we have very few discipled men and women. We actually have very few discipled pastors. I'm sure you're probably wondering, how is it that a pastor is not discipled? Well, the truth is you're asking that question because a lot of times we don't really know what it means to be a disciple. We just assume that a disciple is somebody who has, you know, accepted Jesus in his heart, and the person goes to church all the time, and the person, you know, goes for prayer meeting, and the person is in a department, and the person preaches. All those things are good, but they don't make you a disciple. They are not the core element that makes you a disciple. Now, a disciple exhibits these symptoms. Example, he'll go to church, he'll go for prayer meeting, he'll be in a department, he would, you know, do those different things. But that is not the core of what makes him a disciple. We're going to go to the scripture and find out what is it that makes a man a disciple of Jesus. So in Luke 14 verse 25, I'll read it from the New International Version. It says, large crowds were traveling with Jesus, and turning to them, he said. Now, the Bible tells us that a lot of people were following Jesus, kind of the way it is today. So many people have given their hearts to Jesus. You see thousands and millions committing to Jesus. But then Jesus turns around and tells them something. He says, if I continue reading from verse 26, he says, if anyone comes to me and does not hate father and mother, wife and children, brothers and sisters, yes, even their own life, such a person cannot be my disciple. And whoever does not carry their cross and follow me cannot be my disciple. Now, Jesus made it very clear in this verse. A lot of people are following Jesus. A lot of people are his children. But Jesus has very few disciples. A disciple is the one, the Bible says, would put Jesus first. Obedience to the word of God first. He doesn't put his father and mother and wife and children and brothers and sisters, those things that are very dear to the regular man, he doesn't put them first. He puts Jesus as number one. In fact, the Bible says that you must hate these people in comparison to Jesus. Now, if Jesus is saying you must hate your father, mother, wife and all of that, what do you think he'll be saying concerning your job, your career, your finance and all of those things? If he's saying you have to, in comparison, hate your father, mother, you know, when you're talking about Jesus, you put the work of God first. A disciple is the one that follows exactly the tenets of his master. And discipleship costs a lot. It will cost you the very things that you really care about. It will cost you the very things that matter to you. Let's take a look at what Peter, who is a disciple of Jesus, this is the comment that Peter made. In Luke 18:28, it says, then Peter said, Lord, we have left all and followed thee. This is why Peter is a disciple. He says he left all and followed Jesus. Those things that were dear to Peter, he had to leave them one by one. Doesn't mean you abandon your house, your clothes, your job, and all of that. No, that's not necessarily what he's talking about. What he's talking about is you reprioritize your life, putting your commitment to God first beyond any other thing. In fact, it is so serious that in Luke 9:59, I read it, he said to another fellow, follow me. But he replied, Lord, first, let me go and bury my father. Now, this is a legitimate excuse for anyone not to come and do what Jesus has asked him to do. This is a legitimate excuse for anyone not to go to church or not to serve in one way or that. It's a legitimate excuse. Your father just died. And so the man says, okay, you know what, Jesus, I'm going to follow you, but give me time to settle some family issues that are pressing. Guess the answer that Jesus gave him is verse 60. Jesus said to him, let the dead bury their own dead, but you go and proclaim the kingdom of God. So what Jesus is saying there is that you have your father's burial somewhere around the corner, and at the same time, you have a commitment to serve Jesus. Maybe you've committed, oh, I'm going to do this, or I'm supposed to serve in one way or the other. I'm supposed to do this for Jesus. Guess what Jesus told him? Jesus said, let the dead bury their dead. What Jesus was saying there is those who are not saved, those who are not committed to me, let them bury their own dead. Meaning that a person who is not committed to Jesus is a dead man. He said, let the dead people bury their own dead people. But you come first of all and do the assignment before you think about burying your father or your mother. Meaning that if the two of them clash, if the two activities clash, one has to surrender for the other. And guess the one that will surrender for the other? It is your commitment to whatever it is that you are doing at home. Jesus said, you first of all come, serve me, and then you cannot think about the other one. Now, the thing is that most people would ask you, what do you mean, Jesus? Are you kidding me right now? My dad just died. I was saying I should go and do the service I'm supposed to do for the Lord first. Yes, that's what it means to be a disciple. Do you know that if Jesus was living today and had a church, he would have very few people in his church? He will not have multitude. Do you know why? The reason is simple. Many of the things that Jesus will say, you will not like it. Many of the things that Jesus will say will go against everything you have ever believed. Can you imagine coming to your pastor and saying, Pastor Jesus, you know what? My dad just died and I need to go for a family function. And I know that I'm supposed to sing in the choir today. And I know I'm supposed to preach tomorrow. And I know I'm supposed to be an usher on XYZ day. But that is the same day that my father's funeral has been fixed. And then Jesus says, well, guess what? Let the dead bury their dead. Come and serve. Come and do what you're supposed to do. Then after that, you can go. Obviously, nobody will be in that church. If you read the writings of Jesus in the scripture, it doesn't make any sense. You know, the things that Jesus will tell you to do are just not the kind of things you will expect somebody to say. But that is what it means to become a disciple. That's why discipleship is not a topic for children. It is for people who have made up their mind to follow Jesus all the way to the end. Thank you for listening. We're going to continue discussion on discipleship tomorrow. God bless you.
For other life-changing messages, you can now download the app Rev Oyiks Speaks from Play Store for Android phone users or Apple Store for iOS users. You can also follow us on Instagram, YouTube, and Telegram, all on the handle Oyiks Alfred.